All right, we've reached the end, everybody. I hope you're all fat on turkey, gravy. You enjoyed yourselves. Well, and now you can enjoy this last Spider-Man rewatch as we get to No Way Home. And it's coming up. Man, what an absolute ride it's been so far. We did all of the Spider-Man movies. Last week we did Far From Home, and now we're wrapping with Into the Spider-Verse, and we're excited to talk about this one. It's the Oscar-winning Into the Spider-Verse. So there's a lot, man. There's a lot to talk about for sure. And before we do that, everybody, if you're brand new to the channel and you're just finding us, please subscribe to this channel and hit the notification buttons also. It's very, very, very helpful. And then, after you do that, make sure that you also get on over and check out the podcast feed. Check out that podcast feed. It's very important on audio, so please do that. But I have Winston here. I have Coy here. And we are going to be talking about Into the Spider-Verse. It is the animated film. Lord and Miller made it. A lot of great voices and actors. It's fantastic. And here we go. Welcome back, one and all. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, the rewatch series, the finale of the rewatch series. I am Ralph Biscuits, joined as always,
Ralph Boner,
by Lou Hawaii and Spider-Face.
Happy Black Friday, y'all. You know what I'm talking about. That Black Spider-Man. The Black Spider-Man.
You just ripped your face off. Nice to see you. This is going to be a fun one. We knew that this was going to be a fun one when we talked about kind of planning out. This is
the movie.
It's like one of the best Spider-Man movies.
I'll take it a step further, man. Yeah. This is my favorite superhero movie of all time.
Wow. It's in my top three, and it changes, so I know it's like tied for first for me.
Yeah. I mean, it changes too, because like, don't get me wrong, there is an added bonus you get for being a live action superhero film and done well. But rewatching this for probably the 20th time, you hit so many elements. The story is so well done. Lord and Miller have mastered doing animated phenomenal. The animation. Yeah. The fact that when I first saw it, I saw it in theaters and I saw it in 3D. I normally hate 3D, but for some reason I was like, I'm gonna go watch it in Dolby 3D.
They shot this for that,
and they shot it like a con.
They showed it at Comic Con. When they showed preview at Comic Con, they showed it in 3D. And you said, oh, okay, because that's a little preview.
I'm invested. Yeah.
So what was so great about this one, because this could easily. This is a big risk all the way around.
Yes.
Not only from the animation side of it, but it's also not only are you leading with a character who's not Peter Parker, and for comic book fans, people were geeking out that Miles Morales finally got his shot. But people who didn't know who Miles Morales was, like, well, who's this? This is not Spider-Man. Those are just two risks. Mm-hmm. I don't even think it's the biggest risk out of both. I think the biggest risk is convincing people that a multiverse isn't going to get too confusing in an hour and a half.
Quantum theory for kids. Hard pitch.
It's a hard pitch. And not only that, and then we're going to bring in Spider-Ham, and he's going to be one of the best parts of the movie. Like, what are you talking about?
All the characters are bold.
You would think, well, this is the reason you got kicked off Solo. And it's like,
what that movie could have been after seeing this.
That's what that got people talking about once this was done. It's like, well, maybe they should have finished Solo. Yeah. Maybe they had a particular vision, because they certainly had a particular vision for this, and it worked.
Dude, it's so good on so many levels. The fact that you get your kind of double Uncle Ben moment, which is like depressing to think about, but the fact that he meets his Peter Parker for a second and then he dies.
Yeah.
And then he has his Uncle Aaron, who, like, instead of being that moral compass that Uncle Ben is for Peter, it's the anti-Ben, but there's still goodness there. Yeah. And then he dies, and they even are, you know, we're jumping ahead pretty far, but when all the spider people are like, we all had it. For me, it was my best friend. For me, it was, you know, my father.
And that inverse Uncle Ben landed more in the movie than the comic for me. Mm-hmm. I loved Uncle Aaron as the inverse of, like, power and responsibility. And that, like, it kind of got muddled in the comic book. They really streamlined that.
1,000%. And to be honest with you, I mean, obviously one of the reasons why this works so well, you know, having this, you know, Afro-Latino main protagonist, you also have the idea for a lot of folks that look like Miles, that look like me, where you have people in your life that are really good people at their core, but they sometimes do things that aren't great, but that doesn't mean you throw them completely
right.
out.
Right.
And so even that mentality of like, God, my uncle is a bad dude, but like he's not.
But
you know?
he just made bad choices.
Yes.
And that was the thing.
Now
where,
he's Blade.
And watching is he
the same actor. Yeah.
So but watching all that and watching it with my daughter, because remember I told you guys I was gonna watch
this. How'd she like it? I wanted her log line.
She loved it. Yeah. She absolutely loved it. And she was asking a lot of questions. She was super invested in the story. Even that one scene where Miles goes to his uncle's apartment. She's like, does the uncle know that it's him? I was like, no, he doesn't. Cause he's just chasing this kid. Cause he sees the kid, never really saw his face and this whole thing. But even the setup to the beginning of it and the way that they even set up Gwen, how she goes to school, and Hailee Steinfeld is great in this. I mean,
Jake Johnson.
The Spider-Man we never knew we needed.
Phenomenal.
Yeah, he really is.
Like, the funny thing is, I didn't actually notice at first that it was Chris Pine doing the first Peter Parker.
Yeah.
But to know,
that's a Schmodown question that has stumped some people.
Really? Oh, they thought they were just both Jake Johnson?
I think so.
But I didn't realize that until, which is very funny, then listening to when he's singing the Christmas album in the credits.
Chris Pine just,
why'd I do this thing? I should have had my agent call and got me in the swing.
I want to see that tape. I want to see him in the booth singing that song so bad. I love that it was also a Ben Reilly nod because they made him blonde. Like, as a Ben Reilly stan, it's rare we get, that's the clone of Spider-Man that took over for a bit. I never thought we'd see a blonde Spider-Man.
I thought I found a plot hole for a second watching it this time, and then I realized it gets explained pretty quickly. So I at first thought when they were like, okay, the Chris Pine one died at 26, and then the Peter B. Parker comes in, he's like, I've been doing this for like 26 years. Yeah. And I was like, so he's in his 40s.
Yeah.
How, if they're supposed to be the same dude, how is it that they're at different ages? And then I realized, wait a minute, different. The noir dude is like, my time is in the 30s. Right.
Yeah.
And Penny is like, my time is in the future.
Different timelines.
Yeah. And, everything's possible.
Yeah. It's just the fact that when it opened up and what year it opened up.
You were the spider of that time.
And at that point, when Jake Johnson's Spider-Man was in his 20s, he was probably the same kind of excited Spider-Man that Chris Pines was.
Yeah.
But then down the line, what had happened was he just made all these
shower seats.
The shower scene kills me.
The Mary Jane,
bro. Well, the fact that they even gave a baby nod to One More Day, in the sense it was like,
what's,
you know,
that? Explain the idiot.
The One More Day was the storyline we talked about before, where
Mephisto
he reveals to the world, I'm Spider-Man. Okay. Aunt May gets shot and killed.
Okay.
And so then. To undo that, they break up their marriage.
Yeah.
They did a slight twist on it where Aunt May passed and then I broke up with Mary Jane. So it's
like
a little different, but it's
same,
a commentary on it a little bit because of just how his world fell apart. So even when, in both cases, wanting to talk to Aunt May and Mary Jane, it's like, I don't know if I can do this.
Which
I don't know
loosely
if I can do this.
Ties into what they're doing with No Way Home, which is what we're doing this rewatch for, is One More Day, I think, is loosely how they're doing the magic of Doctor Strange and that going wrong.
Yeah.
So instead of it being Mephisto, or is it, it's going to be Doctor Strange doing the spell that causes the problem. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of an homage to One More Day, which is not a good comic, but it is a good story to branch out from.
Yeah, and so when they set it up, and it's really Miles, though, that makes you care about this story, because he's a sweetheart of a kid. He's a good kid.
Watch Dope. Shameik Moore is incredible.
He's great. I love that movie.
Yeah.
And so he is set up in this movie where you're like, okay, he's got that Peter Parker kind of thing about him where he's awkward. Well, I love that. I loved that thing where that's what is his piece, is the music.
Yeah, right? I
love that. And the music that he's listening to, great music in this movie, by the way, all the way around. And he's listening to Biggie at one point.
I would actually argue, I know how much you love the Elfmans. I think that this Scorn soundtrack is the best out of all of them, personally. And part of that would just have to do with the fact that, like, obviously being a hip-hop head and there's so much tying to it, for me, this trumps all of them, unfortunately.
To me, it connects more directly to the character.
Yeah.
So Danny Elfman is a cool superhero score, but it doesn't feel like Toby because he doesn't have a character.
It felt like his character was alive in music.
Exactly.
Yeah,
and there's a visual, a component to it. Mm-hmm. Like, all the graffiti stuff sounds like the sound of the music. And Post Malone is going to be forever associated with this, unlike Danny Elfman's score, which it's close, but for me, it's this.
I say the score is really good, and it's... But I think that if you played it to most fans, if you took the Spider-Man fan theme from Elfman and this one, if to 10 people, 8 out of 10 people that Spider-Man fans, or I shouldn't say Spider-Man, they'll probably get both, but like, you know, comic book fans in general, people who like these movies, would guess the Spider-Man thing before they'd guess this. I'm not saying enjoyable.
Sure.
And I'm not saying whether it fits the movie. I'm just recognizable.
Sure.
To me, the Danny Elfman Spider-Man theme is one of the most recognizable and iconic. To me, it's still my favorite. Like that, but the overall score, this one.
I mean, in the same way that if you play Batman 89, versus Dark Knight, the Dark Knight scoring, in my opinion, is better, but the more iconic is the 89.
I do think that the Danny Elfman one is better. The main theme, mm-hmm. the overall score, I agree.
Yeah.
But I think the main theme itself is
I still run to this. Sure. Like, put on the soundtrack, whereas I don't generally, dabble.
No, for sure. And again, you not only had that, you had, again, from the soundtrack, you had just iconic songs like Sunflower and things like that tied to it. But I guess that's the whole thing. It's that I understand I was already going to be a little bit biased because anytime genre. You see representation like that, you're gonna gravitate towards it. But I also just, again, from a an objective standpoint, it just, to me, directly resonates with the character.
It also feels like New York. That's so important.
It does, and it's funny. It's a very funny movie, but not funny in the way that I told you that I have issues with.
Sure.
Not funny in the way that, this is going to be funny because we just need a joke here. Like, my favorite line in the whole damn thing is, "We don't pick the ballroom; we just dance." But that's what that character would say in that moment.
It all worked.
And Spider-Ham, the stuff with the delicious pies, and all this. I mean,
they're trying to test Miles. Like, so can you do this? Can you get punched and get back up? And he's like, "Can you float to whatever you smell a delicious pie?"
Yeah,
it's all so insane, and it all works because the movie lets you live in that suspension of disbelief. That's to a level that I didn't think possible.
But it also allows them all to have arcs, right? And it certainly allows the Jake Johnson character to have that arc of where he's got to try to figure it out, and he's got his big fat belly sticking around, but he still has all the Spider-Man stuff. You can tell this guy's been around and done this stuff a million times over. And Aunt May is great, by the way.
Oh, my God.
Aunt May is really good at how she's
awesome. Can we talk about maybe, I mean, I know people love Alfred Molina, but this Dr. Octopus. Can we give Catherine Hahn some respect?
Yeah, I would still give Molina the nod as the best.
Taken off, and like the character design of that Doc Ock, incredible.
I don't know if I give it to Molina. I think I give it to Han.
I'm with Han
now. And only from the simple standpoint of she didn't attempt, and this is weird to say, she didn't attempt to recreate Molina. She really gave her own original take on it.
I thought she was great. I just think that Molina had a little bit more to do. I think that it's Kingpin. It's Kingpin's story as far as main villain in this one. So with the whole thing with he's got to get his Vanessa and this and like what his motivation is with Liebtreiber was
fantastic. And that Sienkiewicz art. So it's based off a very iconic cover artist. So Kingpin looking like that is this one very specific artist, Sienkiewicz. So I never thought we'd see characterizations. I thought there'd be nods to comics forever. They literally made the Sienkiewicz art come to life in this movie, and same with the Spider-Gwen. The color palette is every one of those comics is drawn that way. So I'm really excited for this next Spider-Verse movie. If they go into these other worlds, if the entire world is going to be that color palette, 2099 might do it. Spider-Gwen did it.
Did you notice both when they do their origins, but specifically when they travel back to their dimensions at the end, that it hits you with a color palette of what their dimension looks like
immediately, like her drumming with the spectral trails of purple, all of that straight from the comic books. So this medium of this style of animation allows us, when they make the sequel and they make the Spider-Gwen send off, all those things. And if No Way Home does any multiversal stuff, I keep thinking there is going to be a Spider-Verse connection. They can make it that style of imagery, which is going to blow minds.
I think, I don't know if we're going to get him in the main storyline, but I think we're going to get Miles at some point in No Way Home, just because we already got the setup with Aaron.
Animated Miles or real Miles?
I think we'll get a live action, and they just kept it close to the chest as to who, like in the same way that, is it okay to, what, this is Black Friday. I can give an Eternal spoiler by now, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you haven't seen this, well, I'll just warn people. If you haven't seen Eternals yet,
just for the next 10 seconds, just turn this off and then come right back. So Harry Styles being introduced as Star Fox. Right. So that whole thing, I think the same thing's going to happen where they just had somebody under wraps and then he's just going to appear before this is over and we're going to be like, oh my God.
Yeah, like, I can see that. And I would love if that's a separate little, because again, I have the problem with Tom Holland being still young and Miles being young, that mentorship. But I would love a separate Miles universe, which they can do with this movie. I would also love if it's maybe attached to Andrew, because I think Andrew would be a great mentor to Miles.
That's the thing that I think that they really could do some brilliant stuff here if they do the multiverse the right way, and if they wind up having, as everyone thinks, Toby and Andrew show up, and they're able, because they set it up well enough, because this movie, No Way Home, is going to be one of the biggest movies of all time, as far as box office. Because of that, you have an opportunity, if you do it the right way, and you've been saying this clear for a while, that you can spin off and say, okay, well, look, we've already set up this universe Toby's going to get another. He's going to get the fourth Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Andrew Garfield's going to get his third Spider-Man, and then we're going to introduce the Miles team because it's all a different universe. And because for people going, wait, what the hell's going on? They go, well, you got to see that movie.
Yeah.
No Way Home to figure this out, because now there's a thing as opposed to being so confused with going, wait, what's happening? Like, no, just go watch that, and that's like a precursor to understand how we get here.
One to one, and it's literally Sony owns these characters,
right?
So they don't have to have these handshake deals, and then you could conceptually have Tom Holland stay your MCU Spider-Man or not, and then you've got all these other options. And Spider-Gwen's going to be completely Sony if they want to do it. You could make five Spider-Man movies.
There's so much in it, and they set it setting up the Sinister Six now where it actually makes sense.
As animated Spider-Man's interesting. The freshman year thing.
That's interesting. That leads into Homecoming. We're going to see the origin. Is Tom Holland voicing the...
That is my question, because he didn't voice the What If. So
did
I'm
you
curious.
Ask him?
We'll see.
Okay.
All I was going to say is the one thing I do know is that Disney still owns the rights to animated Spider-Man, which because all of the animated shows have all been on like Disney XD or whatever, so they own that.
But that's what's curious about Tom Holland being Sony's Spider-Man and that he didn't do the What If, and that's animated. So I got questions.
Yeah, I got a lot of questions. anyway, so this is
not a lawyer, but it's messy. But
it's the multiverse that is set up very well in this movie, and it could have been confusing, but it even like, and I wanted to test that. My daughter's a very smart girl. She's very smart. But I wanted to see if she was going to pick it up, how she was going to pick it up. And she was just like on it real quick.
It's incredible.
Yeah. You know the narrative device I think that they did that helped and they made it a joke is that they all did their origins. Okay, let's do this one more time.
And because you start off with Chris Pine doing it, which was great.
It's the best way I've ever seen that many heroes or villains introduced. Because if you look at this movie, I mean, Prowler, Kingpin, Doc Ock,
Scorpion,
there's so
Doc
much.
Ock,
Scorpion,
Tombstone, and I think Green Goblin, you had six. You technically had a Sinister Six. They just never worked together.
Goblin's in this one,
at the very beginning, he's the one that almost kills Pine.
Oh, Gobby. Yeah, he's like massive and
big. That's the ultimate version of Spider-Man's Green Goblin.
Right.
And so that was the other nod that I really appreciated. So Miles originally comes from the Ultimate Verse. We kind of talked about it in the other earlier rewatches. So that's the Goblin in his universe. That's also, if you notice, that clearly Miles's verse is not the one that we're in.
Right.
Because when you look at the random things in New York, instead of Coca-Cola, it's Cola Soda.
Right. Yep.
Instead of Chance the Rapper
Rogan
having
show.
A three, he has a four. Wait, what's
the Seth
one?
Rogen, there's like a big billboard in Times Square of like Seth Rogen on a horse, and it's literally just like that's the whole thing. Like literally Lord and Miller hanging out with Seth Rogen one day, like, we'll put you in it. And there's like Seth Rogen on a horse in one of the billboards.
I didn't even see that. But for me, it was the Chance the Rapper thing, and instead of the
subtle.
Three, he has a four. I was like, that's a very subtle.
We're not there. It just opens it up into a different multiverse.
There's also dozens of Stan Lees in Miles Morales' universe. He's on the train,
right. Here's a question though too, then, because I know that you talked about one point. I really don't want to see it all. I know that we have different opinion here. I don't want to see any animation in No Way Home at all. I don't want to see Spider-Ham show up. I loved him in this. Loved John Mulaney's version of him. I don't want to see that. Hmm. But to go and to play into what Winston is saying, it doesn't mean that you can't take the characters that we see in this movie and tell their story live action.
Sure.
Right? Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of, well, yes, this is what happened, and there's a reference to it, and the Jake Johnson Spider-Man is 40 years old, but it's Jake Johnson.
Yeah.
How about this? I don't think that Spider-Ham needs to be as active the way he is in this film, but if we're traveling through these dimensions or we're seeing them, you just, even if you saw, because like in the trailer, we see like the purple lightning and Doctor Strange goes, they're coming. What if you even just saw Spider-Ham in one of the lightnings?
That's
as a
all
thing,
I think it's going to be.
And nothing else. He might be like, what?
It wouldn't ruin the movie for me.
Sure.
It's just the second you start to Roger Rabbit something that's supposed to be the most dramatic movie of all time, and it's supposed to be so dark, and there's a freaking cartoon pig running
around. I don't even think he'll speak. I think it might literally just be all of this is happening, and then we see one of them.
That's a kind of fun. Look, the same argument that I can make against myself is that Howard the Duck is running around out there, and it's a talking duck,
right?
But it's like, or even Rocket is a talking raccoon.
But
the difference between the two is at least they're animals that are supposed to be physically there, as opposed to a drawing that has come along to speak. Now,
photorealistic Spider-Man would be terrified. Yeah,
if it was a different like universe or setup or tone rather, then I get it. But like from what they're setting up, it's supposed to be serious. But if it's just something in the background, then so be it. But if I see it with either one of you guys and I see him, I'm just gonna look at you guys. I'm gonna go.
I wouldn't be surprised if even though we're really in the moment, just what are you?
Yeah, it's like Sebastian goes, Wait a minute, sir. You're telling me that a cartoon is alive? Turn him into bacon.
Butcher box.
Right. You get a free spider ham.
Hey, it's the holidays, y'all. You get your own free spider ham.
Holy right. Lord. Yeah.
Anyway, so there's a lot of good in this movie. There's no doubt about it. In the way that, and I think that, but once
number
again,
one, I think pretty cleanly.
It is a very rewatchable movie. And what I also like that we should talk about, and we'll talk about it in a second. But it's going to be the relationship between Miles and his dad, which I thought was amazing. Yep. But before we do that, everybody, this Thanksgiving, you got to be thankful for family food and free bets. You guys just ate a lot. Yum, yum, yum. That's right. DraftKings Sportsbook, it is an official sports betting partner of the NFL, has a Turkey Day no-brainer that you can't miss. New customers can bet just $1 on any Thanksgiving NFL game and win $100 in free bets if either team scores a point. So if Sportsbook isn't available in your state, you can get it in on Thanksgiving at NFL action. Make your first deposit, and you can play free for millions with DraftKings Daily Fantasy Football Contest. And that's why we put this episode on today as opposed to tomorrow. Normally we do it on Friday, but it's on Thanksgiving. So DraftKings is safe, secure, and reliable. Best of all, you can deposit and withdraw your cash whenever you want. So you download the DraftKings Sportsbook app right now. Use the promo code BIGTHING. Bet just $1 on any Thanksgiving NFL game and win $100 in free bets if either team scores a point. That's promo code BIGTHING this Thanksgiving. That's today at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NFL. Must be 21 or older. New customers only. Restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com/sportsbook for details. If you have a gambling problem, please call 1-800-GAMBLER. All right. So let's move on into this this topic of Miles and his dad. Because to me, it was the best part of the film.
And now he's Fastos. I'm going to do that with everyone in this movie. And now she's Hawkeye. And now he's...
Funny. Well, but he's so good in this too, because I think that the reason why I liked it so much is that he almost plays the role of Gwen Stacy's dad in this, in a certain aspect.
Yeah, I mean, a cop and authority figure.
Doesn't like Spider-Man, yeah. has an issue with Spider-Man, and then even at the very, I thought it was such a sweet moment when he misjudges the Spider-Man and sees him, and then Spider-Man hugs him, and
he figured out in that moment that's Miles?
Yeah.
Because he definitely says, because especially with the callback to the beginning, I love you, say it, dad, say it.
Yeah, I'm think not that leaving until
you
moment.
Do. So I think when he goes, I love you, he goes, it just so happens that he sees Kingpin, and so he doesn't have a minute to process it. Yeah. But do you think maybe he's picking up on it earlier in the film?
I don't
film?
Know. I mean, I think they're going to play that he hasn't. I think
in the comics he knows, yeah. And in the comics it's interesting because he's a cop now, but he was an ex-SHIELD agent. So there's fun back in the day stuff, which is a commentary on the silly stuff with Peter Parker's parents being agents, but actually landing. It's really interesting how Miles is able to we talked about the Ultimate Universe is able to streamline Peter Parker and make all of his stories great because you have the benefit of hindsight. What Miles is interesting is you can make storylines that didn't work. Like the stuff with the parents, you can make work by seeing what didn't and didn't. Yeah. And then like there's an attempt at the Clone Saga that doesn't quite work with Miles. That just
I heard about that. It was
it's not great.
There's like a don't touch me and all this kind of stuff, and they're all brawling and
it's not great. But Miles is a great opportunity to try storylines that might not have worked in the 60s, 70s, and today.
Yeah.
And I love this movie's thesis statement of anyone can wear the mask, because that allows not only the representation we need, but it also allows every single person to feel seen, which is what I always thought Spider-Man represented. Like, no one looks like Superman. No one has the billionaire money of Batman. No one has that. So even beyond Miles Morales, Spider-Man now represents the everyman in a way that he always should have. The underdog that is Spider-Man, that isn't Tobey Maguire, is a fantastic way to feel like you're not a bully when you're taking care of things responsibly.
I also think that's what they also played very well with Gwen in this movie, Spider-Gwen. Because it also shows you how good Hailee Steinfeld is, right? And that they playing into that in this universe, it's almost what they did with Agent Carter in What If, although I think this lands much better than the way they did that. It's like, okay, this is it was actually her that got bit by the spider. It was her that did this, and she plays it really well, and they work together as a team. And that's also what I liked with the dynamic of Jake Johnson's Spider-Man. He serves as like the Ned to Miles Morales in this. You know, he and she kind of, and they, the three of them have this relationship, or it's even Ned meets Tony Stark is kind of what it is.
Yeah,
right? It's like Ned meets Tony Stark. I mean, Ned in the fact that he's just got a best friend that he plays with, but like it's there is no best
it,
friend.
It almost
no Harry. There's nobody.
No. I get that. I'm trying to think of like a good example. But it's Creed. It's Creed. It's the idea of like, well, I'm kind of retired, but like I'll help you through this, you know what I mean. It gives me those kind
and
of vibes.
It finds your energy again. Like you see the purpose of it. You grow as a character.
All of a sudden, like after, especially when he's afraid of Miles getting killed and whatnot. But then when Miles like, I got this, and he's like, wow, okay, I actually kind of helped this. Maybe I can get my life together too. And he goes back and finds Mary Jane at the end.
Which is beautiful. I love all the MJ stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, next to Zendaya, I think that portrayal of MJ is so strong and it really captures the character so much more quickly than even the Sam Raimi movies. Mm-hmm. And I also really dig the dynamic of like Spider-Gwen's Peter Parker is the Lizard in the comic book. So I love the idea that in these multiverses, we can have familiar characters, and that is how they could do No Way Home. They could have, I mean, I'm not saying this is going to happen, but they could have a Spider-Gwen movie where Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man is the Lizard. They could have cameos from Andrew Garfield playing like that universe's thing, that'd be fascinating.
I think it would be, but I also think it's a lot to ask of audiences who aren't as enriched in this lore as like even I am right now, which normally have not been, right? So like, and only from hearing you guys, like there's certain things that I think that it would take me a bit to realize, like, oh wait, so he's... I never really liked the idea of like Tobey Maguire being Uncle Ben. Never really liked that idea because it's too disruptive, I think, as far as a casual viewer.
And the attachment.
I think.
Especially if you're going to use him again.
While I understand that, I think the only thing that I would say in this regard, this isn't like we're starting out with Spider-Man now and we're just trying to learn about him, so giving too much is too much. I think because as we've done with these rewatches, as we just did with the MCU, you have had years to go there. So there, as long as you do it in a way, so like Black Panther, for example, when it gets introduced, there's a lot of tie-ins to the MCU, but as long as you focus on what is important in that movie, or Shang-Chi, for example, you can do it. You can still play and have a, wait, Toby, wasn't he a... Oh, I guess it's the multiverse
thing. And those stunt castings are fun because it gives the audience a playful thing, and it doesn't have to mess up continuity because it's new continuity. Like, I've been pitching for 8 years doing Deadpool Kills the Fox universe before. when Deadpool was announced, when Deadpool 1 was announced, then it was like a year later they started the Disney buying Fox rumors. I was like, oh, fold them in before Deadpool 2 and have Deadpool kill every character that was in Fox. So Chris Evans comes back, you think it's Cap, but it's Human Torch. Okay. You have Nicolas Cage show up and he turns into Ghost Rider, and then Deadpool kills all of those characters, and then that way he's the one that's breaking the fourth wall in the Marvel universe because he knows like there was actually another universe of Marvel characters and I killed them all. And that way you clean up continuity, you've got stunt casting. Now you can do that in a positive way with Spider-Verse. You can have Spider-Man bopping around and seeing all these other characters, and you get those moments of like, oh, I get that joke, and then you feel like you got the Easter egg. So I think that's an option with live action Spider-Verse.
Well, what I do think that ties into what will tie from this into No Way Home is the fact, just the idea itself of the multiverse, and the fact that this movie found it out before Tom Holland did.
Yeah.
So Miles Morales and everybody else, this has happened already, and this should tie into continuity. That all of that stuff that, oh yeah, you guys are going through this now, that's cute.
Yeah.
We did this already.
Yeah.
And we actually had this kind of battle already. And maybe there's advice that they can give. I don't know. Probably not. But it's just like, just the idea that we know that it has connected, and the fact that they are, with this movie already, making all of the Sony stuff canon with it inside the MCU. So this is essentially canon as well.
You know what I kind of want, to be honest with you? I kind of want Jake Johnson... live action as Peter B. Parker.
I said that before. Yeah, I said like there's a possibility, because if they're not going to be animated, what if when they show up? Like,
I see what you're saying. Now. I don't think I understood what you were saying. I got what you're saying, that they were, but I thought you meant the animated. I'm saying
like,
let Jake come in with the sweatpants and be like,
he's been through this already.
Okay.
Now I get
you. So you're like, Nicolas Cage can be in the old timey 30s.
Eat that up.
Can you imagine Nicolas Cage just doing it?
The Rubik's Cube stuff, incredible.
Dude, it's amazing.
I'm taking this with me.
Is it purple?
Smells like rain.
he was great in this role. Mulaney was great. We don't talk enough about the anime version also, which was
Penny Parker.
She was great too. I mean, the idea that
the Gerard Way comic.
Yeah, is that what it was?
Umbrella
Academy. Had you read it?
Oh yeah. Okay. It's what's really interesting is the Spider-Verse comic.
You must have lost your mind during this movie.
I was like, my whole life I'm came sure. together. I was like, how is this happening for me?
The only one I didn't know was Penny. I knew everybody else.
She's in one issue and it's half an issue. It's insane. Wow. Like, it's one of those comics where the front is one story, the back's the other story.
Yeah.
And it's a Gerard Way comic where they were like, hey, you made Umbrella Academy. You seem to like comic books. Make the craziest Spider-Man. I was like, how is she on screen? Like, it's the most obscure. Yeah. So it's probably the most I've ever been in a theater. And we did, there was a Collider screening. Did you go to that?
Yes.
There was a Collider screening where we saw it the second audience ever. So I got to be the first person to tell Lord and Miller Sienkiewicz Kingpin. And that meant the world to me. Because they were like, you got it. And I was like, oh, I got it. That whole movie, watching it with like 40 of us, it wasn't a lot of us. I've never felt like more like someone went, hey, we made this for you. And now you're going to meet the people that made this for you.
You know what
they
did,
though? I didn't know anyone
would
get it.
I want to jump off that part there because this does tie in. Everything ties back into Star Wars for me.
but made it for you.
No, but this ties into why I get so frustrated when I hear certain things, like if certain people who make creative choices think that things are too inside baseball for people that will never transfer over to the big screen, that people won't understand it because it's just for those potential readers and stuff, right? And then how they never go and they don't transfer books and they don't do these things in these stories. And then you look at something like this. And
I'll just real quick.
So when you look at something like this and when you look at the fact that, like, when you're geeking out about these things and you say to Lord and Miller, hey, you did this, and they go, you get it. Even if I didn't get it doesn't hurt me.
Right.
And it doesn't take it away. It doesn't make me go, oh, I'm lost. You can take and adapt things and take stuff that people love, and you get one of two things. Either you really get people excited like yourself,
or
you bring new people in, or it goes right over their heads.
You didn't care about Donald Glover's license plate. I did. Didn't affect you in Spider-Man Homecoming. Right. Like, what's the license plate?
Do you
plate?
Know why that works? You just tell a good goddamn story.
But they focused
on that first.
So I use this for like Lost Stars to me. Is one of the best books in Star Wars history.
Okay. Yeah.
It ties in the original trilogy in a way that doesn't bring in any, I mean, you know, Tarkin shows up or whatever too, but it's like a cameo.
Yeah.
But it's really about, it's a love story inside of it, and it's brilliant. Rumor, don't know how true it is, heard that they were working on doing it as either a series or movies.
Yeah.
And it was scrapped because it was a book and nobody would care.
Wrong.
That's the same thing that you're talking about.
It's the difference between Iron Man 1 and Iron Man 2. In Iron Man 1, in the background of one scene is a half-finished Captain America shield. Yep. That was one of our first Easter eggs.
Yep.
Everyone lost their mind. It was the internet sensation. The problem was in Iron Man 2, they then made it a joke, and he wedged that into a pit of technology to make that thing work. You went from being like, oh, that's subtle and interesting, to like, this is an Easter egg!
Right.
And they literally crammed it at our faces, literally.
But
in that
also,
movie.
It doesn't make sense once you then get to the first Avenger, because he has it back in the 20s.
Yeah, and it's also 40s, frozen with him. Me. Well, why would he get, like,
exactly.
So that's when you lose
sense.
It is like you throw that
and
stuff
the characters
off.
Are really flushed out, thought out. Who do you think had the best hygiene out of all of them?
Hygiene, yeah. I would probably say Spider-Gwen. She had really lush hair.
Spider-Gwen, I agree. I mean,
she got pissed when her hair got cut, bro.
So it was lush?
Yeah.
Yes. And I'll tell you what, she definitely uses Quip. I was going to tell you that right now.
For sure, 100%.
She absolutely uses Quip. You know that she does. She's got some clean breath, and there is something that you must do. There is something you have to do. And what has made my life easier... Sorry, hygiene is so important. Health practices. I absolutely love Quip. They make brushing your teeth. They make it fun. And I'll tell you, good health, what it starts with, good habits. And what Quip does is they make it very easy by delivering all the oral care essentials that you need to care for your mouth. So the Quip electric toothbrush, it is loved by over 7 million mouths, and here's some of the things that it has. It's got a lightweight and sleek design for adults and kids with no wires or bulky charger to weigh you down. It's got a multi-use travel cover that doubles as a mirror mount for less clutter, a reusable handle in a range of sleek metal hues, including best-selling all black and all pink, as well as bright plastic colors sure to make a pop to your bathroom counter. And on top of your brushing, you can upgrade your Quip with a new smart motor to track and improve your brushing with the free Quip app. Earn amazing rewards like free refills, products, Target gift cards, and more. Now, beyond the brush, Quip has everything you need to build a complete routine. There are two ways to floss, ladies and gentlemen. There's floss string that expands to clean, a reusable floss pick that replaces over 180 disposable picks with every refill. That refillable gum that's sugar-free has long-lasting mint flavor, and it comes with a dispenser. So what you want to do for yourself is you want to go to getquip.com/bigthing right now, and you're going to get your first refill free. Your first refill is free at getquip.com/bigthing. getquip.com/bigthing. Quip, It is the Good Habits Company. Love that quip. And you got quip, Winston.
Yeah, so does Koi. It's,
yeah,
it's great, man.
It's quip house.
Yeah, right when they were kind of still in their startup phase a little bit, like, yeah. I got a chance to try it out. And to the point where I bought a second one and left it at my girlfriend's house, so I always had one to get a regular.
Yeah.
And then once we moved in together, I was like, well, I don't need two now. So then I replaced the head and was like, here, have the one I left at your house. And now she loves it.
I'm telling you guys, check it out. Like,
it's one of the rare things that I knew was a sponsor that I bought myself upon hearing about it. Like, I didn't wait for the sponsor. I was like, no, I'm going to like this. I'm going to get it.
Yeah. And it's worth it. Use that code, man. Get a refill.
The biggest thing people don't realize, because you've always been told you need to brush your teeth for about 2 minutes. People don't realize how long 2 minutes is. Until the quip thing helps goes, you out. You're like, it's still
I'm still
going?
Brushing. Yeah. I'm still brushing. Yeah, as true. Someone who spent $6,000 in dental work this year, brushing teeth. Wow. I was really bad about brushing my teeth for years. I also dated three hippies in a row, and they were very like anti-fluoride, pro-charcoal. So I kind of like broke my teeth with charcoal because you wear away the enamel. And quip is slowly getting my mouth back after spending thousands. I put a used Honda in my mouth this year. Didn't have it.
There's a multiverse where you got to just never use charcoal. I'll tell you that.
Lesson learned, folks.
All right. This is, the other thing is this movie is short. It's about an hour and a half. Goes
great. In
it
and
goes
out.
Quick, in and out. The second one. Does the second one have to do, is there any repercussions from No Way Home that play into the second one, do you think, at all? Or Lord Miller's like, we don't want to deal with any of that. Just let us do our own thing.
I assume they're going to do their own thing.
That's what I would assume.
It depends.
Yeah.
If we see anything in No Way Home, I do think it affects it. If we do not get any references from No Way Home, then I think they're doing their own thing.
I think Sony's going to play. Like, I think they want to keep everything like Sony.
Mm-hmm.
This is exclusively Sony. This isn't Sony in association with Marvel, I don't think. So it does give the opportunity to like, hey, we did this thing with Marvel. Let's benefit over here by having it tie in. I just don't know how much No Way Home will have the space to set something up.
Yeah.
Because I could see a Flash. Actually, maybe that's it. Maybe a Flash happens with one of the characters, and then that scene is in the sequel. So we go like, oh, I saw this for a second. That's what I would do, personally.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. I mean, it's just a trailer. So, like, I already was trying to, like, put piece together, like, quickie spoiler for Venom, Let There Be Carnage, but we talked about it previously. At the end of that film, you see them see the same broadcast of Peter getting his identity revealed from J.K. Simmons. So I'm even curious how that's going to play in No Way Home, to be honest with you. So there's a lot going on already.
How I want to end today, because we are there's anything else as far as Into the Spider-Verse that we really need to hit? That because we hit a lot of the stuff with the uncle.
The last thing is, I think that this is the best developed Spider-Man figuring it out. I know he has mentors to help him, but even the idea of like he goes to try and do the jump, he's like, nope, and walks right back down the stairs.
It's just funny.
The fact that he's like, come on, man, you got the best way to learn is just by doing it. And he tries to use the thing and he can't. So he's like, running. He's like, you gotta swing or you're gonna die.
Yeah.
And then like eventually he gets to that place because he still can't control his individual powers of camo and the Venom Blast. That when he's like, I have to do this or they're gonna die, that he makes his suit and then he just does the leap of faith.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden he's swinging and he's doing the thing.
Yeah, Leap of Faith song, man. Every time that it gets you.
Well, even when Jake Johnson first shows up and he's bonking his head around, he's like, and that line by the cop, he's Spider-Man dragging around a corpse. And
it's such a funny movie. Yeah. Also, Bagel. Funny movie. The Bagel movie. Bagel.
Like, oh, dude. When he's like, okay, so here's the plan. We sneak in. It looks like the comic again. We sneak in.
Yes.
We do the thing. I hack the computer. It's not really hacking if you know the pattern. No, don't worry about that. I hack in. I get the thing. I pick out a bagel and we get out of there. And they're, again, running.
The visual word bagel when it bonks the head gets me every time.
Dude. And then they get the computer. And they're sprinting for their lives, and then they're stopped, and it's all the scientists just sitting there eating lunch. And he goes, "Ooh, let me pick out my bagel." And they go, "Spider-Man!" Everybody pulls out a gun. He's like, "Oh crap!" Like, oh
yeah. And I'll tell you, from someone I remember when working at the Bachelor, the day that everyone looked forward to the most
was
Bagel Wednesday.
Oh wow!
And like, so when that happened, I was just like, "Yeah." Someone,
I know this world. I know this corporate world.
If someone takes an extra bagel or something, you better.
I just love
the Stanley cameo is one of my favorites Stanley cameos.
Yeah. Well, especially with the no refunds, and he just giving that cheesy ass like
it always fits eventually because it's a great moral lesson and it's snarky.
Yeah.
I also think it's kind of the anti-Robin problem in the Batman comics. Like in the Batman comics, it's Batman and family and there's just way too many Robins and it's really messy. And I was like, do I want 5 Spider-Men? And then this movie's like, no, you do.
Nah, it plays it well.
It really balances a family and it's better than some of the comics.
And that's what we're going to talk about to end the show because we're going to be this for those people. Maybe you just stumbled upon this episode. We did a full rewatch of the of every Spider-Man movie, from the three Raimis to the two Andrew Garfield to the three, the two previous Tom Holland ones.
Two plus, yeah.
Leading into now No Way Home, and that's why we wanted to do this. We are going to be doing a spoiler-heavy discussion of No Way Home. I'll be doing a separate review of that, obviously, too, but we're going to be doing a full review of it, the three of us, a discussion on it. So we wanted to kind of lead up, and we'll talk about just a few more things as we are right around the corner. By the time, like I said, this is coming out on Thanksgiving, so we have like what, 2 weeks before the movie comes out.
Yeah, it's second week of December, yeah. Right?
Yeah, 13, yeah. 14. And we'll also be doing rewatches of Matrix because that also comes out pretty soon. So, okay, before let's start talking about No Way Home then. Unless there's anything else you guys want to talk about with.
I think that it is, last thought total is, I think that more animated films can learn a lesson, yes, just in general about trusting your audience. Because yes, this agreed movie, mm-hmm, especially following this up with the Mitchells versus the Machines, mm-hmm, it shows that like you don't have to make it for kids or adults. Much like comic books, you can just make it for audiences and yep, you get what you want out yep of it.
Yeah.
If more animated films trusted their audience, I think the medium of animation wouldn't be seen as a genre. Because it's not a genre, it's a medium.
I agree with the point. I also, but that's my previous point. I don't think it just needs to be something that just animated pays attention to. I think it's just like what Winston said, it's story.
Yeah.
If you have a good story, trust in it, because if the good story worked in a comic book, if the good story worked in a video game, if the good story worked in a book, if you do it the right way, it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work.
Yeah.
But if you do it the right way, I always use the example. It really bothers me that like the Darth Bane novels haven't been made into sure like anything, mm-hmm, because there's such great stories. Mm-hmm. Not even touched, at least for now.
And then right, lean into your medium. So those books, you can yeah have longer conversations because it's a book. But then when you go to animation, for example, the stylistic stuff yeah like that, this, you yeah can have five different universes yeah that are feeling jarring. When you go into down live action, yeah, you can have conversations with MJ well, that's, and Bridge well, that feel
but
like.
But that's
you
know a good mean point though too, because this movie that we're talking about, because with the animation, you got to make it's an hour and a half. You can't do a 2.5 hour, 2:45. You'll lose people in the 2:45 sure animated. It'll be too hard. I mean, not the hardcore animated fans, 100%. You're going to stick through it. But this reason this movie was so successful is because it did cater to all audiences, and those audiences were able to sit through an hour and a half, do it. But you can't do that with No Way Home.
I agree, and I certainly hope, and then we got to get to the No Way Home talk because I know we got to get out of here soon, but I hope. Because the one thing that really sucked about this film was they did not hit the box office that they deserved.
Not
for
at
as good
all
as a movie.
Did they not?
They did
it,
not.
It did
they
okay.
Did, they did okay.
But like this got an Oscar and also should have gotten a Best Picture nom, not I a agree. Best Animation. It should have gotten both.
Are you
guys
sure? Best,
yes.
It did fine.
It did okay. That was the thing. It ended up being not a flop per se, but they did not
but do it wasn't a Spider-Man movie.
Well.
Numbers? Not at all. That being said, like this really is, it deserved the Oscar for animated, but it deserved at least a nom for picture.
I agree with you.
And that might have gotten it a little bit more. Because if people see that it got nominated outside of its medium,
right,
that might have pushed something.
I agree. Well, because a lot of people are like, oh, Toy Story, you know, got, you know, whatever.
We're starting
great,
to get some.
Because it's no, for guys. Kids, but.
No, this movie made almost $400 million worldwide, and it's an animated film that did not cost. The difference is like, it didn't, like you said, Spider-Man movies normally. Like
if you,
it billion. Has gotten
yeah,
this.
But those movies cost like $100-$200 million to make. This is not cost.
I understand that. I'm saying that like as of after winning the Oscar, because you know they always re-release yeah. the stuff after they win Oscars, that bumped it up. When it initially came out, it was not doing numbers.
So it cost 90, which means with advertising, it probably was about $1.80.
So it made 190 domestic.
Yeah.
And then plus international, so another 185. It made $400 million.
It was in the black domestic, so all international is profit. That's right. Actually commendable.
Yeah, so but it made...
I'm with you, but I wanted to...
I know that it probably you wanted it to be this massive thing, but also... Whether or not you want to argue or not, how I agree with everybody that animation could be is for everyone, but it is still associated by a lot of people as for children, which it's not.
And it's still commendable but to do four times what it cost to pay off its marketing.
$400 million for an animated movie that's
yeah.
not Pixar.
Sure,
that's not you know it's that's good.
That's commendable.
That's really good.
That's fair. I see both sides of it because I want the Spider-Man numbers, but I also see the medium thing with the yeah. public. Hopefully, the next one now that we've got it out there, maybe Spider-Verse 2 yeah. will get those Spidey numbers.
And remember, $400 million. You're like a billion is not something that is
happened
easy.
Often.
It doesn't happen.
It's happened like 15 times.
It was only because it happened so. It was we
it
had
was happening
succession.
A lot.
We had a freak thing that happened like Fast and Furious, and all these movies started yeah. making $1 billion, and everybody was like, "Oh, it's easy to make $1 billion." It's a now. Especially after the pandemic.
Well, now after the pandemic, yeah. God help you. But like there was a period of time when Jurassic World came
everything
back,
was
when Star
billion.
Wars
yeah,
came
it was
back.
Like three yeah, a summer. Right, right.
It, it everything 100%. Was not all the Disney live action remakes, right. They were all clearing a billion.
All right, so let's get into this because we're gonna get out of here and everybody's gonna go eat their food and eat their gravy. So this was this trailer drops. We all enjoyed watching it. And now, is there anything that we think after watching all of these movies now, after watching everything, after seeing the trailers now, anything that we thought beforehand that we don't think anymore, that we do think even more?
I think Dr. Octopus becomes good. Yes. I think that Dr. Strange is bad. I think
You think it's the what if one?
I think it's the what if one because I think the line in the trailer is going to be intentionally misleading that they're all coming in. I think that's him talking to villains about Spider-Man's coming in. I think it's an intentional bait and switch. I think also that Electro starts out blue and turns into the more comic accurate Electro that we get. I think that I thought that Lizard was only going to be a cameo. He looks to be much more of a thing, but I don't know if that's
Lizard gets punched in the face by one of the other
Spider-Man. I keep saying he sneezed because I want Sony to love me like they do. It looks like he sneezes.
Miles, he's camouflage punching. That's Miles, right.
He sneezed. I also think that Sandman might not be the Sandman we think it is. I think he might stay Mummy Sandman or Thomas Hayden Church is trapped in a way, but I don't know if that's our Sandman.
I think it's gonna be a different Sandman, yeah.
Yeah, so those are my new thoughts upon rewatching that trailer.
My thought process is that Jay was saying that he thinks that it's the switch, so that it's the Doc Ock from Andrew that we see in this movie, not the Toby one and then all that. But the only reason why I disagree is because he was essentially saying that it was a flip for all of the villains. Why I don't agree with that is because we had a Green Goblin or a Norman Osborn that died in Andrew's universe. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden, Willem Dafoe comes in. That doesn't make logical sense in that regard.
They pulled right before their moment of death, they mentioned death in the trailer.
Right, yes. He does. That their fate was they all died at fighting Spider-Man.
And again,
Sandman didn't die.
Right, and neither did
Lizard.
And Lizard didn't. But here's what you also got to realize, that this goes back to the same conversation of not everyone is as locked in as everybody else.
Sure.
If for casual movie fans who know the Spider-Man movies, Tobey Maguire, if you're like, well, no, actually, it's he actually was in Andrew Garfield. No, it wasn't. You're confusing the audience right away. So there's no way that happens. It's going to definitely be Doc Ock. But what we saw in that Spider-Man 2 that we just watched recently is that he still has good in him. It happens. He helps Peter at the end.
I think the nanotech that we see in the trailer fixes the neural link that makes him control the.
Yeah,
the
I don't think he's part of this whole thing. I think he's helping.
There's a quick shot when Electro becomes like the comic accurate Electro, and he shoots. It looks like he hits Doc Ock.
Okay.
So I think that Doc Ock is on the side of the spiders.
I think he is too. I think he's working with Tom Holland and the kids.
Yeah.
And I think that's why that whole thing is, you know, it starts out with them imprisoning him or whatever. And then they let him out. He gets the thing out of his head and he comes to and he's helpful. And he's going to, and that's why, because we all love Alfred Molina.
Right.
So it's going to pain us again when he dies again, but he's going to pain us this time that he's fighting on the right side. And it's
dude, the fact that they're teasing the Gwen Stacy death was Zendaya, I was about to flip my, I was like, don't you dare.
Everyone is speculating that hand that comes in that's Andrew Garfield for his redemption.
But I can't imagine they'd.
But I think that's how they introduce Andrew. I don't think that it just comes in randomly where he had. I think that Tom is like no, and he can't get to her, and then Andrew's hand catches her, and that's how we're like, oh, here he is.
I've heard that a lot. I think it's not that. I think it's Tom actualizing that he's the ultimate Spider-Man by being able to save her. I think if you have, because it's mirroring the Andrew thing. Andrew wasn't able to save her. If you have Tom be able to save her, that's like, this is our universe's Spider-Man. Right. He did what no one else has done.
Right. I mean, look, and then we have, from what the leaks and the rumors and all that stuff too, is that the three of them look like they're going to be fighting together. And it looks like the fact that they're going to fight together in the sneezing.
Here's the question. Who do we think is the sixth? Because again, we got the teasing of Venom, so there's the potential of that.
I think Scorpion.
It could be Scorpion. We also have Vulture kind of sitting around.
I tell you
potentially.
How proud of myself that I am.
Dude, I am proud of you. The fact that you got both of these.
I wouldn't have got that.
The deep dive worked for you. Got it up here.
Because I look at it, because in my head there was like the little voice that goes, "Say Scorpion." I was like, "Scorpion."
Oh yeah, I know this. Saying how good does that feel? Instead, like I think Easter eggs are dope because that you got that experience. It's not going to hurt somebody else, like you just said. Scorpion.
But trying to figure out who number six is, because it's clear the Sinister Six is happening. We have a number of people as options. We have Venom, Vulture, Scorpion,
Mysterio. I think Mysterio is the fifth.
Oh, yeah, I think you're saying Mysterio.
Because you keep saying that Doc Ock is good, so you're not concluding him as part of the six.
I'm not
exactly.
I'm not
so
either.
I think Scorpion and Vulture are the six.
Yeah.
And I think Venom's post credit.
Well, that's what I was just going to ask. I think that as well, especially even not seeing the post credit scene that I've heard about everything. Mm-hmm. Right. It just because if they're setting you up in this post credit scene that he's seen this thing with Tom Holland revealed, why are they setting that up?
Yeah.
If they're not going to pay it off at all.
And that was my only thing where I think that he has more of a thing than a post credit. Like, why would you introduce him at the end of that film
and have another post
to
credit?
Not, you know what I'm
I
saying?
I just can't imagine putting Venom in as a side note.
I think you put him in a post credit. I think you put
it a moment.
Yeah. I think you post credit and you set
and then Venom 3 or Spider-Man
and you
in
set
the universe.
Tom Holland to come up into this third Venom.
Maybe that's the maybe because again portals are opening, maybe Venom does see him and then there's a fight with Venom and he kicks him back through a portal, so he's not in the final battle, but there's some
so
sort
do
of
do we think there. The multiverse is going to be an absolute mess after this, and that's why into the
madness
multiverse.
You mean?
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. But do you think that that's what happens? Do you think that we're going to...
Oh, yeah. I think this is WandaVision. I think this and WandaVision happen simultaneously with Loki. I think timeline-wise, WandaVision, Loki, Spider-Man, all the exact same time, all lead to Doctor Strange 2. I think Doctor Strange 2 is the culmination of these three giant events.
Yeah.
And then I think the fallout of Doctor Strange 2 leads to Loki Season 2 and Ant-Man Quantumania. So I think
Loki has to happen first. And the only reason why is, remember, they've been pruning all those other timelines. So once the TVA is now defunct, then this spell happens. And that
the time is for that show is like infinite. It can happen at any time.
Well, I also agree, but that's what I'm saying. Before the point of being able to use the spell to open that up, I think that Loki has to happen where it's like no one is pruning anymore.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it causes more madness. Yeah.
So I think it's.
I don't think they can squeeze it in before Doc Strange though.
What do you mean?
Like the timeline wise of release, I don't think you can have Loki season two exist.
No,
that's not what I'm saying.
Oh, sorry.
He's saying at the end of
Loki one,
killing
He Who Remains is what allowed the TVA stops and the pruning isn't happening anymore.
So you're saying Loki has to happen before WandaVision and Spider-Man.
And then WandaVision and Spider-Man happen around the same time.
I hear you.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So just in our current continuity, Loki's already happened. Yeah. And then, okay, I see you.
Because there was no, he said it. There was a multiverse. I stopped that shit.
I still think there's some hijinks with Far From Home, timeline-wise. I still think there's something going on with Jake knowing about the multiverse. I think it was meant to be snarky because there's also a great moment where Jake goes like, call me Mysterio. And it's like a joke.
Yeah.
I think there's also an element of like, it's a multiverse. Like, I think he knows something for real.
He really
real.
Knows about the multiverse.
And there's also a moment with in that movie. Oh, J.K. Simmons. There's something with J.K. Simmons. Like, I don't know what it is, but I feel like those two
God,
things.
What's he smiling at?
In what?
That's
a good question.
Yeah.
What's he smiling at? He's in the Venom universe as well as this universe. What if it's the bait and switch and there's a third universe?
He's in the Venom. Oh, Venom universe because I see the
right.
At the post-credit.
What if that is a different element? Like,
well, but him in the Venom universe doesn't, because if they see that scene from they see that scene from the end of Far From Home,
right?
Doesn't that just put them in the MCU?
It does now,
right?
But we don't know if there was another Jonah in the Venom universe. Right. There's so many questions with Venom.
General, and look, we are only a few weeks away, ladies and gentlemen, from this movie, and this was a series that we had a lot of fun doing, and so much so that we finished all the Star Wars ones, we finished all the Spider-Man ones, Matrix is next, we're going to be doing Batman. There's so much that we're going to be doing. So excited to be doing all this stuff and so excited that you guys did this with us. I thank Coy and Winston. Guys, it was a pleasure doing this series with you. So much so that we're going to be doing more stuff together. Not only will we be doing the Batman stuff, we're going to do, when we're not doing rewatches, the three of us will do some more Big Thing episodes and talk about some other stuff going on. And obviously, No Way Home will be doing our full spoiler discussion. But thank you guys so much for joining me. It was a great series. I'm sad to see this one end, but there's more stuff coming up. So thank you, everybody. Make sure, by the way, if you haven't already, please subscribe to this channel. Very important to do so. And hit that notification button also. A lot of reviews, reactions, bunch of stuff. And there's Coy again with
No Way Home, you guys. It's coming.
Yeah, but check out the Big Thing, everybody. Apple Podcasts. Leave us a rate, review, Spotify, anywhere the podcasts are found. I want to thank you so very much. Appreciate it.
I almost forgot. Yeah. Did we give our final ranking of the movies?
Oh, shoot.
Bring it back.
I should bring it back.
Just real fast.
Okay, let me look. I wrote mine down.
Well, you want to do it in the beginning of our...
Oh, and the spoiler review.
Let's do it in the beginning of the spoiler.
All right. Take us away.
We'll do the beginning of the spoiler.
Time for our 90s Spider-Man animated series rewatch.
Before we get into it. So, all right, guys. Thank you so very much for joining us. Enjoy your day. We miss you. We love you. Peace out. All right.
Yeah, we did not. So we should open.